Welcome to There's Sometimes a Buggy, Irresponsible Opinions about Classic Film. I'm Elise.
I'm Dave. And this week, it's the Hollywood Studios Year by Year, 20th Century Fox, 1947. We've got a pair of noir classics for you, Boomerang, with an exclamation point, and Kiss of Death. After that, stay tuned for Fear and Moviegoing in Toronto. We saw three films at TIFF Lightbox this week, Everything Everywhere All at Once, Who's Afraid of Virginia Woolf, and Spellbound. As always, we begin our Hollywood Studio episode with a look at the roster of stars under contract during that year. This is taken from Joel W. Findler's The Hollywood Story. He has his chart where he assigns 1, 2, or 3-star ratings to all of the people that he sees fit to put on his infographic. Dana Andrews, 2 stars. Anne Baxter, 2 stars. Betty Grable, 3 stars. Gene Tierney, 2 stars. Richard Conti, 1 star. Gene Crane, 2 stars. Clifton Webb, 2 stars. Gregory Peck, 3 stars. Dan Daly, 2 stars. Tyrone Power, 3 stars. Linda Darnell, 2 stars. Gene Peters, 2 stars. And Richard Widmark, 2 stars, making his debut in one of our films here.
Where's Victor Mature?
As always, Findler leaves much to be desired.
Very mysterious.
We've complained about this before, him leaving Victor Mature off his chart, and John Payne.
I have no memory when it comes to our reactions to the chart. What's with this Joker, and why do we use him on our podcast?
It's the only chart I know of its kind. So we'll be starting with Boomerang. Before we get into it, we'll delve into another coffee table book, The Films of 20th Century Fox. This is by Tony Thomas and Aubrey Solomon. Boomerang continued Louis de Rochemont's objective to make filmmaking more realistic.
Who's?
The producer. Louis de Rochemont. He's the docu-noir czar at 20th Century Fox. This was based on a true story, the unsolved murder of a priest in Bridgeport, Connecticut. The film was shot in Stamford in the same state, with many local people there being involved. The central character of the story is a state's attorney, played by Dana Andrews, who is called upon to defend a vagrant, Arthur Kennedy, accused of killing an elderly churchman. The evidence seems conclusive, but the attorney doubts it, and after much trouble manages to prove the man innocent. Boomerang's success brought new concepts to American filmmaking, particularly in regard to location shooting, and it began a new wave of realism, allowing directors like Elia Kazan to tell their stories with much greater credibility. Produced by Louis de Rochemont, directed by Elia Kazan, screenplay by Richard Murphy, based on the article The Perfect Case by Anthony Abbott, photographed by Norbert Brodin, music by David Butolf, and the cast, Dana Andrews, Jane Wyatt, Lee J. Cobb, Arthur Kennedy, Sam Levine, Robert Keith, Taylor Holmes, Ed Begley, Carl Malden, Carol Williams, Lester Lonergan, Barry Kelly, Louis Leverett, and Whirly Birch.
Yeah, so obviously these noirs are very different from Preminger noirs, which was the kind of Fox noir I was previously familiar with. I didn't realize that it would be the producer of Boomerang who was responsible for that, or I would have looked into him. So what do you know about this, Dave?
Oh, I wouldn't say I know that much about Louis de Rochemont as a person, but I know he's always credited with helping to kick off this vogue of docu-noir, which really just means noir using a lot of location shooting.
Well, and based on real stories. Kiss of Death was not produced by him, but I guess he started a trend at the studio.
Right. And it does become a more general trend. I mean, we've seen some of the Anthony Mann movies from the late 40s definitely tap into this. They've got that voice of God narrator, a lot of location shooting that's still manages to maintain the aesthetic qualities of noir.
Apparently, before he started producing, he was one of the creators of the monthly theatrically shown newsreels, The March of Time.
A development on a theme.
There are almost no women in these movies at all to speak of.
Jane Wyatt is stuck in that female role, although she has the extra distinction of having helped to bankroll the head creep of the film, Ed Begley Sr. But yeah, you're right. These two films, well, Colleen Gray, I think, is slightly different, but we'll talk about her in the other movie. In this one, yeah, you've got just a bunch of men, a bunch of great character actors for the most part, and Dana Andrews. You've got Jane Wyatt off to the side, having the occasional conversation with Dana Andrews when he comes home. And you have a real piece of work, Carol Williams, just trying to railroad her ex-boyfriend to the chair out of pique for being dumped. Those are our two female characters.
So this was fairly interesting, I thought. Never seen it before.
Oh, I really like this movie.
The whole thing turns on Dana Andrews has to interest us in his moral dilemma, because that's it. That's all the movie's got.
Well, it's a profile in courage story, basically.
They tell us at the end of the movie it was based on an actual DA who went on to become
Attorney General of the United States.
Yeah, in the FDR government.
The idea here is that everything is set up for him to take the easy route, prosecute a sitting duck defendant. The evidence is all there as far as the police department is concerned and everyone else in the city. Even the opposition journalists concede that this guy committed the murder. They just want to see if they can make some dramatic hay out of the fact that he's a decorated veteran.
Right, and initially Dana Andrews is part of the group. I mean, the first part of the movie is set up to show us the pressure that the Reform Party is under to solve this crime before the election.
That's the beauty of this film, and I do think it's a pretty great movie. It really takes its time to introduce you to all of these people, and it tells you these are the white knights of the politics in this town. They've thrown out the old corrupt machine. They have, you know, a moral stake, we're told, in maintaining power, but they get into the same kinds of dilemmas that any administration is going to fall prey to. Since they've got the reins of power, all eyes are on them. There are constant elections. All of the people we meet are in some way or another elected or directly dependent on elected officials. You know, success or failure in just about any high-profile task could mean the end of their control of government and the return of, you know, the corrupt slickers who were running things before, who have their own newspaper and ready to jump on any mistake.
Right, and this is fairly high stakes because it doesn't look very good when a friendly neighborhood priest gets shot on your watch.
Right, they say that, right? This is no shooting in a pool room, which apparently nobody cares about. This is beloved person in the community. It's absolutely imperative that the criminal be caught, brought to justice with a minimum of delay. We see the murder occur right before our eyes, just as many people out on Main Street that night did, but no one's close enough to really see who committed this action.
In terms of a portrait of American society, it is a fairly shocking setup that we get introduced to this small city that functions like a community where everybody knows each other, and then specifically introduced to Father Lambert, and then all of a sudden, you know, he's getting shot in the back of the head in the middle of the street.
He lights his pipe. He's waiting to cross the street. Instead, he crosses over into the great beyond.
It's like a Norman Rockwell painting with a priest getting shot in the back of the head. I thought it was interesting that the narrator who introduces us to all of this doesn't seem to be aware of the flashbacks that show us who the murderer is.
No, because that's totally made up.
Yeah, well, that's what I'm saying. It's like there's two different omniscient seeming consciousnesses at work in this movie. There's the filmmakers and the cameras, and then there's the narrators, and the narrator has a blind spot here.
Yeah, the narrator gives us the public version of the story and explains that after all of this was said and done, nobody knows who killed the Episcopalian priest. I guess he was high church.
Yeah, but then the camera is like, but I'll show you. I'll show you what really happened because I represent reality.
We don't even know the name of this guy. We don't know even the nature of his problem. he's just a real...
Some kind of addiction, you'd assume.
Right.
Alcohol, drugs.
And he's been going to Father Lambert with his problems, and Father Lambert is getting increasingly demanding. Let's not keep dithering around about this. You've got to clean up your act, or I'm going to clean it up for you.
He's going to send him to the sanitarium.
Yeah, this is a total invention. The movie makes that clear, and by leaving it out of the narrator's discourse, that's the best way to do this.
So yeah. I was saying that the camera or the movie is showing us reality, but you're saying it's showing us invention.
Possible reality. The movie's definitely saying the DA got it right, and this man who was railroaded, played by Arthur Kennedy, is not the murderer, so someone else did it. This could be the kind of scenario it was. And ultimately, that's not even the main point. That's why it works so well, because the real issue comes out of nowhere, but it's intimately linked to the pressures that we see described during the first half of the film, because one of the big movers and shakers on the Reform Party is not nearly as reform-minded as he ought to be, Ed Begley Sr. He's getting into a little graft of his own, and that becomes the main engine of the plot during the second half.
Mr. Smith goes to Washington.
Or just good old Toronto graft with Doug Ford always somehow involved with the people that are going to profit from wherever our subway line goes next.
As we were saying, the first part of the film gets us on side to really want them to find somebody to take the rap for this murder in time for the election.
But on the other hand, we see just how ridiculously impossible the task is. Nobody really saw the person's face, and that's pretty clear because all the drawings look different and they create some kind of a composite that's worse than useless. Lee J. Cobb is the police captain. He's really the scapegoat for everything, right? Because everyone's just breathing down his neck. Bring us in the killer. Bring us in the killer. Put every man you've got on it. He's like, I have every man I've got on it. There's nothing to find right now. And in fact, it turns out there was never anything to find. Because what are you supposed to find? They're looking for a man with the most banal combination of clothes ever. All they can rule out are women and maybe a few men that aren't the right height.
It's funny, too, because this was clearly an act of desperation that the murderer may not have even thought he'd get away with, because there were a bunch of people on the street and they just happened to not catch him.
Right, well, he's not a criminal mastermind. We certainly see that. He's just a sweaty addict with maybe some other emotional problems that are dragging him down. He's not gloating. He shows up every day at court. He doesn't have like an evil smirk on his face. He just looks stunned and terrified the whole time, every time we see him.
The way Jane Wyatt gets involved in the plot.
Yeah, she shows up very early in a flashback. Before we see Dana Andrews, we see her, because we see how involved Father Lambert was in the affairs of the city. They were involved in the planning commission, which made this big decision to set up this recreation center for the town's children.
Yeah, she is childless. We find that out, and this is why she has all this time on her hands to get involved in community politics. Ed Begley presumably asks her for the loan of this money in order to protect himself, and he's relying on the fact that she's not going to mention this to her husband.
Well, it's her money, right? She said
it is, but you might, if you spent your own money, you might just mention it. Oh, darling, by the way, guess what happened today?
True.
It felt like a small plot hole, but perhaps it was based on what really happened.
That's unclear. Ed Begley, too, doesn't exactly come across as a mastermind. He just seems like one of these sad, moderately powerful men who wants more and makes a terrible mistake and regrets it and is willing to make ever more morally compromised decisions as he goes along until he finally shoots himself when he's exposed.
See, I feel like Jane Wyatt and Dana Andrews have one good scene together, which is, well, I mean, although that happens much later, I don't know if we want to talk about Arthur Kennedy first, but the scene where she realizes that he's thinking about abandoning all of his values.
He's been offered the governorship by people, most of whom don't know that there's a problem. A. Begley does. Everyone else just thinks, okay, everything's going great. We really did find the murderer. The police seem sure. So just, you know, dot that I and cross that T in court tomorrow, and governorship is yours. Meanwhile, Dana Andrews has come to doubt. And he's also, I mean, he's feeling terrible because he pushed his friend, the police captain, into finding someone and getting the goods on them. And now he's going to start to peel back the layers of incompetence in that railroading. And of course, we see step by step how Arthur Kennedy was pushed into the dark corner of the jail cell.
But to finish with the discussion of that scene, since now we're discussing it, I did like the way that, you know, because we only get this tiny little glimpse of the movie's idea of a middle-class marriage, and I liked the way that they each treat each other like children.
Well, she's trying to make him eat sandwiches and drink milk.
Right, and he is trying to not actually let her know that through her stupidity, they become involved in a major way in the town corruption, which may lead to the death of an innocent man. But she isn't quite as stupid as he thinks she is, because she does, as soon as he mentions this, I mean, I do like the nonverbal communication that goes on between them. I like this idea of a marriage where neither of them can really perceive the other as an adult or speak to each other like adults, but somehow the crucial communication happens anyway.
Basically, what she says is that she trusts him to make the right decision, and if they wind up having to go back to living in a one-room apartment somewhere, she's okay with that, even though she'd prefer to go to the governor's mansion, but not if it involves him in compromises that he'll never be able to live down or get over.
I just thought it was a very nicely written scene, the way they read between the lines with each other.
Yeah, it is. In structure, a lot of the film, I mean, it does follow the Call Northside 777 format for these docu-noirs, right? Because, again, you've got a wrongfully accused man. Here, it's at the stage of the inquest, rather than someone who's been in prison for ages that Jimmy Stewart just kind of stumbles over. But you've got a very bitter man in a jail cell, and you've got another man who slowly starts to think that this is more important than his career. Arthur Kennedy is awesome in this movie. I mean, he always is, and we've seen him a lot in his grand 50s phase.
Just before we talk about Arthur Kennedy at last, I was just glancing at the cast list here on Wikipedia, and there's an Easter egg in the movie. A joke cameo. One of the suspects in the lineup.
Oh?
Arthur Miller.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
I'll have to look for him next time. It's really the Arthur Miller?
According to Wikipedia.
Okay.
Uncredited.
I guess he would have been friends with Elia Kazan. Yeah.
No doubt. Well, Elia Kazan was the first director of Death of a Salesman.
So Arthur Kennedy is picked up because he vaguely fits the description. He left town at the right time to make him seem guilty of committing this murder, and he has a .32 caliber weapon on him. On that basis, he's extradited to Connecticut from Ohio, and the police go to work on him. Lee J. Cobb runs a fairly decent precinct by noir standards. They're not getting out the hoses and beating him, although he has a lieutenant that says, you know, we can do this the easy way.
No, but they engage in torture regardless in order to get the confession. They deprive him of sleep, and they have a psychiatrist on hand who keeps making leading statements about his motivations, which actually sound very clever, very convincingly clever in the way, you know, a movie might present a murderer's motivations this way.
It's like production for use.
Yeah. Priest became the embodiment of all of those handouts that you resent so much since you
came back from the war, lost 5 years of your life, and can't seem to get started. And of course, this is a very familiar character from late 40s film noir. It can go many different ways, but in this case, it has not turned him into a criminal, but it certainly has put him on a collision course with trouble. He's not satisfied with any of the jobs that he can get. He's starting up brief flings with waitresses who are liable to be offended by such behavior.
So, I mean, it is interesting that the good guys in this movie are portrayed as getting an innocent man's confession by coercion.
Yeah, absolutely. Under pressure. Lee J. Cobb has been told, if you can't do it, we're going to bring in someone that can. And the movie does a beautiful job of this. And Lee J. Cobb's a great actor, and he really manages to convey all of the nuances of that. I mean, he takes pride in his work, and he thinks that he's keeping enough of an open mind that even though they're using all these techniques, he's not going to let it get to the point of a confession, unless he gets some other proof, like a slip up on the part of Arthur Kennedy or some material evidence that starts to build the case up. And unfortunately, that's what he gets, some misleading information from his ballistics experts.
Yeah, as soon as he is himself convinced as he needs to be under the circumstances, that's when he's like, okay, well, the confession is just a formality so that we can speed this up.
Because again, yeah, they have been depriving him of sleep, but that's been to break down any kind of well-formulated defense. You do get the sense that he would not allow them to force him to sign a confession that Cobb doesn't believe is true. As soon as Ballistic says, yeah, it's the same gun, he's like, all right, fast forward.
Yeah, regardless, it's a coerced confession.
Well, of course it is. Of course it is. And he feels terrible about it. And Dana Andrews saves him from having a man's execution on his conscience.
So Dana Andrews becomes convinced enough of Arthur Kennedy's innocence to undo all of the work that he's done just by having a conversation with him.
That scene has to be great for the film to work. I think it does rise to that standard. You know, something happens between those two actors in that scene. It does bear the weight of the complete deviation that Dana Andrews takes after that. It's not even his idea to go talk to Arthur Kennedy, which I really love. He's just planning, okay, well, the police gave me all this evidence, looks good, I'll see him tomorrow in court. And then he's told, well, why don't you go talk to him? That way you can weasel some more ammunition out of him. That's the pretext upon which he goes to see Arthur Kennedy. Instead, it's the complete reverse. He becomes convinced someone who really committed this murder wouldn't be talking this way. And that's a real hunch at that point. The movie makes you think that he's just going on gut instinct. But when it comes time for him to present in court what he's been doing, we see that they invested an immense amount of the DA's resources into various recreations and reinvestigation of the ballistics, and so that's all withheld by the film.
Oh, right, there's some tense theatrics.
Yes, the 17th attempt to fire the gun at a certain angle becomes the coup de grace. You can definitely see the lineage here. This is Zanuck, 20th Century Fox. You can sort of trace back some of what we see here to the Warner Brothers films of the early 30s, which also would engage in unflinching looks at the justice system.
I mean, I don't have a real sense of how groundbreaking this would be for movies. I assume Elia Kazan's involvement is interesting. I assume that you'd have plays dealing with this kind of issue a lot, or it would be reasonably common to have serious drama dealing with this sort of thing, and obviously people were familiar with it from news stories. This story was published in the Reader's Digest, which is as middlebrow as it comes, but criticism of the American justice system isn't something that I tend to associate with film before this period of crime drama.
Zanuck was gone by the time Warner Brothers made They Won't Forget, but that's certainly in the mold of the early 30s Zanuck Warner Brothers films, and that's another movie where we see all the pressures that are put to bear upon civic officials and all the motives animating the main characters in our civic drama, none of which have anything to do with seeing justice done. We've got a much more morally righteous consciousness at the center of this.
It's also unnerving to see most of these people. It's kind of unnerving to see most of these people at least trying to do what they think is best. You know, not just being blatantly corrupt or malicious.
Right, and I love the Sam Levine character. He's the newspaper man on the opposition daily scandal sheet, right? Which is run by the corrupt Taylor Holmes, who will be in our second feature as well. He's got a very cynical attitude about his job and about the job that everyone is doing in the town. But he really comes through at the end as well by burying the story about Begley's scheme. Because he's a good reporter, he has figured out that there's something going on between Ed Begley Sr. and Dana Andrews, but he doesn't exploit it. Presumably his boss would love to splash that across the front page, but Sam Levine has a righteousness of his own that is manifested at the end. Well, on the whole, I think a really interesting effort by Elia Kazan and crew. What did you think of the ending where they take this anonymous guy and kill him off in a sweaty car crash that he swerves into when the police just happen to drive near him.
To be honest, I did not even remember that happened, so that's what I thought of that.
I think that's there, obviously, because of the production code. The murderer, since we know who it is. It
doesn't seem necessary, considering he's barely a character.
Right, well, I think that's why they decided to do it this way. This anonymous man. Justice is done cosmically, and we're aware of it, so the production code is appeased.
Right, but okay, that does bring up the cake and eat it too aspect that Dana Andrews being, even though they haven't caught the man, Dana Andrews' sterling morality and courtroom theatrics leads to the Reform Party being popular anyway.
Because it becomes a feel-good story. Hey, we didn't kill someone who was innocent.
Yeah, we almost did. We almost did just to win an election, but now we'll win the election by not doing that.
And of course, we just glossed right over the attempted lynching.
Right, I was thinking, because this is supposed to take place in New England, how common was it in the mid-20th century for a lynching of a suspected murderer to just happen? Was that a common thing?
I have no idea if this was based on reality or not, right? Or is this part of the film's larger critique of American society? The narrator tells us, you know, yes, it's Connecticut, but this could be anywhere. And it really glosses over some of the differences between New England and other parts of the United States. I think we could take issue with how similar Connecticut really was to the Deep South. But the movie wants you to think about this as a typical American town and the events that take place as typical of any American town. The zeal for a mockery of justice on the part of the rabble is always lurking on the outskirts of this film and in many films of its kind. The unease with crowd amorality is certainly present here. And Carl Malden and Lee J. Cobb are all that stand between Arthur Kennedy and the end of a rope.
Well, I mean, obviously the idea is how easily this man who's become socially alienated and disconnected can be used as a scapegoat.
Absolutely. It does give Lee J. Cobb that he's never been presented as a villain anyway, even though he's forcing a confession or it's being done under his watch, and he's the one that gives the final go-ahead on it. But on the other hand, he takes his duty to protect this prisoner seriously.
Well, yeah, except when he's arranging for him to be hung or whatever, electric chair.
But at that point, he believes the man is guilty and it will all be done according to law.
Yes, but he believes it, and we're shown that he believes it very conveniently.
Yeah, well, that ballistics report was very convenient, and it does seem like those people should be fired. Dana Andrews shows that basically almost any bullet fired from a .32 will be indistinguishable from any other bullet fired from a .32.
Completely exposing that the entire police department is totally incompetent.
Should have brought in the FBI. Let's move on to Kiss of Death. We'll go back to the films of 20th Century Fox for our capsule review. Kiss of Death continued Hollywood's concern with realism, particularly in depicting crime. Henry Hathaway insisted on shooting this film entirely in New York, achieving an authenticity that made backlot depictions of that city a thing of the past. The central character is a small-time crook, Victor Mature, who would prefer to go straight, but who is caught in circumstances he cannot control. He is given a 20-year jail sentence for robbery. A district attorney, played by Brian Donlevy, who feels the sentence was unjust, offers to help him if he will reveal his accomplices. At first, the man refuses, but agrees when he learns his wife has committed suicide and his children are being threatened by the accomplices, particularly one of them, a psychopath named Tommy Udo, Richard Widmark. That's actually not correct, but we'll get into that. A Kiss of Death met with excellent critical and public response and served to debut the film career of Widmark. Produced by Fred Kolmar, directed by Henry Hathaway, the screenplay by Ben Hecht and Charles Lederer, based on a story by Eleazar Lipsky, photographed by Norbert Brodin, so same cinematographer, music by David Butolf, who also did the music for the other film. Cast, Victor Mature, Brian Donlevy, Richard Widmark, Taylor Holmes, Howard Smith, Robert Keith, Carl Malden, Anthony Ross, Mildred Dunnock, Millard Mitchell, Temple, Texas, J. Scott Smart, J. Jostin, No mention of Colleen Gray here. I guess that's because she got the "and introducing Colleen Gray." But she should be on that list, guys. So what did you think of this one?
I last saw it when I was in my 20s. Most of the noirs I had seen up to that point had femme fatales in them, so had some kind of central female character. This just seemed like wall-to-wall men doing men things. From the time I was a little girl, even though I was gender non-conforming in lots of ways, any book that had no women in it, any movie that had no woman in it, just bored the pants off of me in advance. I've since matured a little bit in that respect.
Victor matured.
And can tolerate that now and then more. And I really, really love this time.
I think it's one of the best noirs.
Yeah, it honestly bored the living shit out of me the first time I saw it, and despite the lavish display of psychopathy from Richard Widmark, who I enjoyed more in Roadhouse, but he's not the main attraction here. The main attraction is Victor Mature's performance, which is incredible, and the writing and direction of the movie, which is even richer and more interesting than Boomerang. I actually found the Kazan movie less interesting in its depiction of police corruption, let's say, than...
Well, it's police incompetence.
This movie. Well, not corruption, but yes, incompetence, but not just incompetence, but the way that the entire system is set up against Mature's character, even though the movie keeps on pleading and pleading and pleading and saying, no, really, the police are doing their best. No, really, the police are trying to protect him. But they're not. They are just trying to make a scapegoat out of him. They are just trying to use him for their own purposes. And the platitudes they're giving out about morality and about good people and bad people are just absolute nonsense, which is emphasized by Colleen Gray's narration.
I think that's a really important aspect of the film, that we're told the story by a very unusual narrator in the context of film noir. I mean, we've also seen Raw Deal in our travels through noir, which is narrated by a female character as well, but it's very uncommon.
That's true, because the male narrator is common in film noir.
Oh yeah, sure. And we got one of those in Boomerang.
More common in film noir than in any other classical Hollywood type of film.
But here, I mean, this is... Colleen Gray is telling us from the first moment we see Victor Mature, okay, this is a guy you've seen in a million movies getting ready to rob a jewelry store, but you can tell she deeply loves this man and is telling the story in a way that's going to be different. And the movie certainly lives up to that.
So she's telling us about his background and how the system makes it impossible for a man who was a convict to go straight. This movie seems to contain all of future Martin Scorsese within it, including the psychopathic gangster.
Sure.
With the help of her narration, but also with the help of Victor Mature's performance, we are on the side of the criminals, and we're mostly focused on him as they try to get away with this robbery. We are feeling their tension as they're trying to get away from the scene of the crime before they are caught.
Yeah, I mean, they're robbing a jewelry store on the 29th floor of some crazy building.
Seemingly on Christmas Eve, from the amount of Christmas shoppers.
It is Christmas Eve. That's what Colleen Gray tells us.
Right. More and more people with packages just keep getting on this capacious elevator, stalling their getaway.
These poor sweaty guys just wondering, is the man we tied up gonna get loose in time to set off the alarm and screw this whole thing up for us?
And he is.
Yeah, we keep cutting back and forth between the elevator and the clerk. It's a very tense beginning to the movie. This is the kind of thing that you'd often see at the end of a film, with the heist going wrong, everyone either being shot or taken into custody. Here, it's both. Victor Mature gets shot callously by the police and survives to get the book thrown at him.
It's also very Hitchcockian in the way it makes you identify with the criminal and also brings major suspense out of something as ridiculous as women getting onto an elevator with packages.
One of the accomplices trying to get off at the fourth floor, right. And he's like, sir, this is not the lobby.
But it's not Hitchcockian in that Hitchcock wants us to identify with somebody who is bad, and that's not what's being portrayed here. We're supposed to get inside of this man's skin, not so that we can feel what it's like to be a bad person or someone doing a bad act, but so that we can sympathize with him, understand him, right? Empathize.
Someone who had no other options, as far as he could see, but to rob a jewelry store without killing anybody, to try to put some food on the table for his family. And he is a family man, and that comes out fairly early in the film. But he's the only one that's caught, and he's brought before the assistant DA, Brian Donlevy, who wants to cut a deal with them. There's a whole bunch of things acting on Victor Mature's consciousness here. He does adhere to the code of not squealing, but there's a practical reason for that as well. He believes, and he's been told, that his organization, the people that arranged for them to commit this heist, and then presumably they were going to sell the jewels and give a small cut to the grunts that did the work, there's going to be some kind of a fund that is used to support his wife and kids while Mature is in jail, like a union strike fund or something.
Also familiar from Scorsese movies.
It makes sense to him not to give anything away.
He has to rely on his criminal connections to take care of him and his family because he can't get a regular job.
No. So he's ready to take his sentence.
It's fun to watch Victor Mature putting on the tough guy act in this scene with Brian Donlevy.
Impervious to all, from his perspective, corrupt offers from the DA.
But he is putting on an act of being a hoodlum.
Yeah, sure.
Because we don't see him acting this way in other scenes.
It's not his actual character. So he's ready to do his time and keep his nose clean and maybe get out early on parole. And he's been assured by Taylor Holmes. Again, here he is the sleazy lawyer who is the...
He's the crime boss lawyer.
Basically, yeah, he's the top of the totem pole. We don't see anyone else above him. He seems to be arranging for everything. He was the one that was going to profit from the heist. Hauser is his name. He talks a good game, and he assures Victor Mature that, don't worry, he'll be out in no time. But meanwhile, he reneges on his promise, presumably, because the kids and the wife are starving and have to move, and the wife winds up taking up with another hoodlum out of self-preservation. That's what the movie makes us think. Not because she's taken in by the charms of another man, it's because she needs another man to help her survive. And we never meet this wife, we don't see her, but it sort of sketches out what a miserable hell her life must have turned into.
I can just tell you this about the filming. So a deleted scene, reading from Wikipedia, a deleted scene involving Nick's wife Maria, who was played by Patricia Morrison, was cut from the film. In this scene, a gangster, who is supposed to look out for her while Nick is in prison, rapes her.
Yeah.
Afterwards, Maria commits suicide by sticking her head in the kitchen oven and turning on the gas.
It's so horrible. Even just hearing about it, and Victor Mature plays it so beautifully that, I mean, the emotion's all there, even if you don't see the scenes. Now, in the remake, we do get some of that stuff. I really like the remake from the 90s, which has...
I don't think I've seen it.
We should watch it. David Caruso plays the Victor Mature character. He's actually really good.
So did they put the rape scene back in?
Basically, yeah. Well, you know who plays the equivalent of the Widmark character. It's none other than Nicolas Cage as Little Junior Brown.
You know, I think I have seen that. Now love that you mention it.
There's a great scene where Nicolas Cage is bench pressing Hope Davis, and it's her only scene in the movie.
We might have seen that.
We might have. Anyway, it's really good. It's not quite as good as the Hathaway film, but you do get to see a little bit more of the wife before she dies. Again, the way Victor Mature plays his angst over not hearing from his wife, you know, there's no hint of the kind of vindictiveness that you might get in another type of movie, right? Like where he's thinking, if I find out she's been cheating on me, I'm gonna beat the hell out of her. That's the kind of thing you would see in a crime picture that's got different aims. He's just heartsick and worried because he hasn't heard from her. And he's talking to a fellow prisoner who says, well, I heard someone from our neighborhood's being sent up. He can give you all the news. When the news is finally delivered, it's, how is she? She's dead.
So you think he's really in love with his wife because he pretty much falls into Colleen Gray's arms after only a couple of meetings with her.
Well, they know each other.
Yeah, she was the babysitter.
Yeah, I know. But he has been away from his wife for years at this point. Right? I mean, yes, he only found out that she died right before he sees Colleen Gray again. And I think what the film makes you feel is that he was in love with the idea of having this family.
Well, yeah, and then he makes a new one.
Exactly. And Colleen Gray certainly does her part. I think she gives a great performance in this movie. She doesn't have a huge number of scenes, but this is not your typical wife of a criminal off to the side kind of role. She gets like this amazing scene where she confesses her intense horniness for him.
True.
That's part of what breaks through. I mean, that scene where she first comes to see him in the prison and he tells her, I'm not the kind of guy you have to sugarcoat things for because nothing matters. It's just incredible, his performance. And the way that she takes that as a psychic blow, just seeing him like this, is really great. And Colleen Gray is going to go on to have a pretty stellar career in noir and in other films too. And she never plays a femme fatale. I mean, she's always just a good person in a noir, but I don't think she's ever one of the boring examples.
We have, when he's on his way to prison, that's when we first meet Richard Widmark's character, and Victor Mature isn't interested in this character at all.
No.
But what we initially learn about Tommy, Udo, is that he has an obsession about squealing. So the fact that he knows that Victor Mature didn't squeal, that makes him a bestie.
Oh, yeah.
A bestie for life, whether he likes it or not. Well, okay, maybe not for life.
It's ambiguous. I don't know how intentional all of this is supposed to be.
The homoeroticism?
No, that's not what I was going to talk about,
sure. Well, there's lots of that.
Well, yeah, there is. But I'm talking about, why is Brian Donlevy going to his prison cell and having this conversation with him? Film, on the face of it, is presenting all of Brian Donlevy's actions as just uncomplicatedly one thing. Just, I want to make you this offer. But as you were saying before...
No, the subtext is clear. There's an intentional subtext of they're screwing him over at every turn, and that their morality is either hypocritical or, if sincere, it's garbage.
You know, that's what makes me think that this is all by design, that he's already been refused by Victor Mature, and he goes to see him in his prison cell, and he knows that he's in a cell with a total maniac, stages the scene where Victor Mature is able to dramatically refuse to be a squealer, and he does help to put him in good.
Oh, so you think they already have this plan from the very beginning that they might be able to use him against Tommy Udo?
Yeah, well, I mean, he's just trying to plant a seed. He's like, well, it can't hurt me to make Victor Mature look good. Maybe he'll find something out from Tommy Udo, and we, you know, can, who knows what the future brings.
And we can manipulate him. We can definitely manipulate Nick.
Now, again, it didn't necessarily have to come to anything, and it wouldn't have if Taylor Holmes had just fucking given the stipend to the wife and kids. Since it didn't go that way, everything comes up Donlevy because Victor Mature is ready to emerge and become an informant on the man that he becomes friends with, all because Brian Donlevy gave him a chance to demonstrate his criminal integrity.
Although he does, in exchange, want to be able to see his kids, right?
Sure. And of course, yeah, that doesn't cost the law anything. Why not, right?
And, you know, it's a pretty moving scene when he sees the adorable little girls. We skipped over the fact that it's written by Ben Hecht and Charles Lederer, two pro screenwriters. The fact that this man is so nice that he even loves little girls, right? He doesn't even regret that he doesn't have a son, because he loves these little girls for themselves and not because they're some kind of representative of his ego.
No, he's explicitly shown to be a great family man. The only reason he got off on the track that he did is because our society is fucked up. And because...
Well, his own father was a criminal.
Yeah, his own father was shot to death by the police in front of him when he was a child. He had almost no chance, despite all of the fine instincts that he has. That doesn't help him get a job and make an honest living.
Yeah, so obviously the movie is very unsubtly letting us know that you won't necessarily be turned into a sociopath just because you are turned into a criminal by your socioeconomic circumstances.
No, but you might be a sociopath as a criminal, and that's what Richard Widmark is there to do. We get nothing of his backstory. We have no idea why he is the way he is. Can't have been a pleasant childhood for himself or for anyone that had to deal with little Tommy Udo.
So we get the famous Grand Guignol scene where we see exactly how serious he is about hating squealers when he decides to murder the wheelchair-bound mother of Rizzo, on whom all of this has now been pinned by Nick, or the squealing has been pinned by Nick and the police.
Really the only vindictive thing Nick does in the movie.
Well, he doesn't know this is gonna happen.
No,
he probably thinks Tommy Udo might kill Rizzo.
Well, I'm sure he thinks that. I think he's okay with that. And even though the scene was cut, I mean, he still has his suspicions about why his wife would put her head in an oven. It's not just that they're desperate for money and she feels a little guilty about cheating on her husband. Obviously, terrible things have been done to her and she just can't go on living. And Rizzo is a part of that. So yeah, Victor Mature is quite all right with framing Rizzo as the squealer. But yeah, Rizzo actually is never punished in this film. If he loved his mother, he's punished that way.
My God!
Otherwise, he's living it up in South America, maybe with Bogey and Bacall from Dark Passage.
Doubtful. Yeah, so we get the scenes where Richard Mature is making up to Richard Widmark and trying to get the goods on him. We get a scene with the two of them and
Buster.
Tommy's girlfriend, Buster. And it's pretty fascinating, their interaction, because she's standing up to him.
Up to a point.
Right, up to a point. Like, she isn't just completely cowed and docile, but when he threatens her with violence, it's clear that whatever he does when she goes past the limit is more than a normal or other than a normal beating. He's a sadist.
Yeah, poor Buster.
Clearly, she just takes up with gangsters and didn't know what she was into with this one.
Right. I mean, she doesn't seem to have gotten a lot out of it. She did get the ring that becomes important to the plot. But as you were saying, Widmark is much more interested in Victor Mature than in Buster or any women who you can't have fun with.
Yeah, I don't think we're meant... This is not a homosexual subtext. It's the usual gangster homosocial evil. It can also be played as a kind of true love, as in that Jean Gabin movie, Touché Pas au Grisby.
I don't think there's that much of a comparison, because that's more of the long goodbye.
No, it's not a comparison. I'm just saying that there's a wide... When you have gangster homosociality, there's a wide spectrum there, and it's not always evil, but here it's evil.
Yeah, it's very one-sided, too. There's nothing going from Victor Mature toward this guy.
But I mean, as part of that, as part of the homosocial bonding, Widmark then takes him to a whorehouse.
Sure, of course.
Which is very subtly portrayed, I have to say, but unmistakable.
Yeah, they're both big men. Big man.
The number of times he uses that phrase in this movie.
And it comes back, too, right? In O. Henry's Full House.
Becomes an important phrase associated with Widmark.
Widmark loves that. He doesn't call anyone clamhead in this movie. That's only in O. Henry's Full House.
But Widmark trademark.
We mentioned it earlier, but this movie made a star of Richard Widmark. And he's not in it very much. And as you indicated, and I agree, I think Victor Mature's performance is the greatest thing in this movie. I mean, Widmark has given much more interesting, nuanced performances elsewhere.
Yeah, no, this is not... I mean, I guess I can see...
But it's one of the great performances of its kind, for sure. Extremely one note by design.
You know, sometimes people just like to see something in a movie that's more horrible than anything they've ever seen before, like Betty Davis in Of Human Bondage, or Richard Widmark in this movie.
Right. But I think, as you were intimating earlier, his performance as Jeffy has so much more nuance to it, even though it's eventually equally insane. But there's actually some pathos there, too. And here, there's none. This is just...
Oh, yeah, there's some pathos. There's some warped likability.
There is something there, because he's hurt by Victor Mature's betrayal. But he's just such a caricature from the beginning that you can't feel for him.
In Roadhouse...
It's a real friendship that goes awry.
Yeah, and also, you have to work really hard. Or, let's put it this way, it's not that hard to make even the most insane stalker, as we were saying when we were talking about Joan Crawford just a few episodes ago in the Curtis Bernhardt Possessed from this year, it's not that hard to make an insane stalker in fiction sympathetic. That's disturbing, but true.
Yeah.
In this movie, this man is just a sadist.
Yeah, I mean, he's a complete maniac. Got a bit of a sense of humor of a very special kind.
He likes to giggle. He likes to have a laugh.
Another difference between this film and the remake is I think Nicolas Cage, there is some pathos. He's kind of noble in a way, but he's also a complete psychopath. They do spend a lot more time developing the friendship between him and Caruso, which is under false pretenses, and Caruso is an informant, and he gets really angry.
So everything toward the end here, we're heading for tragedy. So apparently in the original ending of the movie, Victor Mature dies, which was considered too depressing, but he essentially dies anyway. I don't think it's an ambiguous ending, and even her statement at the end that she got him could be referring to the past tense.
Could be, true.
I read it as he dies. This is how I read the movie.
This is just how it was for me.
He's shot over and over in the stomach.
Yeah, I know.
And all the police had to do was, like, all they had to do was coordinate on this and give him a bulletproof vest.
Yeah, but they can't be involved in it. That's the whole point, right? They tell him, we can take you into custody and that's all we can do. We can't connive with you on some kind of plan to go up against Widmark and see if he pulls out a gun.
Is there no witness protection program in
this? There is. He is under witness protection, right? He's living in another town under a different name, but it's not going to do any good. The criminal underworld always finds you, according to this film. Anyway, that's what he tells us. It becomes so important that we've seen how Tommy Udo operates, that if he doesn't find you, he kills everyone that you care about. And that is so much more threatening to Victor Mature than anything that might happen to him.
I mean, in addition to just being a shockingly sick movie scene, the wheelchair murder establishes what kind of threat he is, because what's interesting in the final sequence is that you would expect, like in another movie, Widmark would be menacing his wife and children. But here, no, he's menacing Victor Mature and you are scared for him.
Well, sure, you are. But what you're really afraid of, more than him killing Mature, is that he'll kill him and get away with it, because then he probably will go and just kill Colleen Gray for kicks and the kids.
Well,
right?
I don't know. If he can't make Victor Mature watch, I'm not sure if he cares.
We'll never know. We'll never know. But in Victor Mature's calculation, the only way to put Widmark out of circulation is to take the steps that he does, since the police aren't amenable to any other solution. Taking him into custody is the worst possible option, because then Udo will spare no expense in tracking down the family.
The moment where you know for certain, that the police are going to... The police come back in this movie the way that the pimp comes back in Mama Roma.
Yeah, sure.
Because we have this idyllic scene that we referred to before where they, I guess the police have helped him get this job and helped them get this house, and they're living a nice working class, small town, family life.
Yeah, the kids have roller skates and he's working at a quarry.
And, you know, it's not ideal. Colleen Gray is emphasizing how awful it must be, but it doesn't matter to him because he's got a home and a family. He can live a normal life. He is teasing her, but just because he wants more display of love out of her. Teasing her about how, oh, you better hold on to me tight. Don't let go. I might miss the excitement.
He hated the criminal life, clearly.
And then they get the call from the police. One more favor we have to ask of you, then it'll be over. It is. It's the pimp.
Yeah.
The pimp from the past.
You're going to have to come to court and testify and show Tommy Udo specifically how you betrayed him. And don't worry about it. We're going to get him. And you know that there's some problem with this plan, and indeed there is.
Well, you know the problem is that the police have no difficulty with using this man that they have pretended that they want to help, just using him and toying with his life over and over again.
I like the way the movie plays it because Don LaVie, I mean, he's a very good actor as well, and he invests it with more than one valence. I mean, yes, they are using him, and ultimately the system
The system is using him. This man in particular isn't a bad man.
He is earnestly upset when he calls Victor Mature to tell him that we actually failed to make our case.
But they were taking that risk with him.
Yeah, of course.
We have to feel that.
It's both. He's been callously used. Don LaVie clearly is broken up about it as well, but that's not going to change the way he operates in the future either. That's just how the system works. You turn hoodlums against each other in an effort to get conviction.
So yeah, I feel that it ends up with Victor Mature having to sacrifice himself.
Yeah, because they leave him no other option. If he goes and shoots it out with Tommy Udo, if he doesn't die, he's going to go back to jail and Colleen Gray is going to be miserable and the kids are going to lose their father again.
Which means that ultimately he is killed by the police.
Or severely wounded and recovers and gets to live a nice life.
If he was definitely dead, then it would have been horribly depressing. But regardless, it felt like a very Carlito's Way ending to me.
Yeah. The only thing against it is Colleen Gray's kind of hopeful tone or grateful tone at the end.
Oh, and wait, that could be elegiac.
It could be, as you say.
So this is just, really, this is a brilliantly directed and written film with great performances, and particularly by Victor Mature.
Yeah, I'm glad you agree. He's a very underrated actor. I think I've made that point several times. Underrated especially by himself, right? The most famous story I know about him is that he applied for membership in a country club later on in his life and they told him that they didn't accept actors. And he's like, I'm not an actor, just ask any critic.
And to be outshone by Richard Widmark in this movie, certainly one of his best acting opportunities.
All right, let's move into Fear and Moviegoing in Toronto. Start with Everything Everywhere All at Once. This was the final film in the Women in Action summer series at TIFF.
In 2022.
It won Michelle Yeoh the Oscar.
Did it? It's a very good performance. I just didn't realize that.
I did like the performance. I didn't like the movie very much, ultimately.
I liked the movie. I enjoyed it. You didn't like it at all, despite the fact that it's actually handling the multiverse, and we watched many films of this kind when we were doing the time travel movie podcast?
Yeah, I just didn't really find its interpretation of multiverse theory all that interesting. It was a little too jokey for me.
No, well, the point of the movie, clearly, and how it's been taken by critics, is that it is big-hearted. It's not just jokey.
Sure, but it was pretty jokey.
You can't have both?
You can, but I didn't think it did have both. I mean, her performance really centers the movie in a way that almost makes it all work, but not quite for me. I didn't hate it. I mean, I gave it 3 stars, I think, on Letterboxd. I mean, the performance of her daughter, the character of her daughter, is excellent as well.
Yeah, I agree. I think that they were both tremendous performances. I liked the husband as well.
But honestly, I would have preferred to see a movie about this family without the multiverse. I think I would have liked that a million times more.
Well, that's weird. That's like saying, man, I would have enjoyed this David Lynch movie a lot more if it was just about, you know, this woman who is investigating the past of the amnesiac girlfriend that she acquires in her apartment.
Yeah, but I don't know any better way to say that I didn't enjoy the multiverse aspect of the movie. I enjoyed the setup of the characters and the possibilities for drama there. But I didn't think we needed a bagel of nothingness.
Too silly for Dave.
I'm sorry. It just wasn't funny to me. And
it's obviously the movie did not tickle your sense of humor.
No.
I have had to sit through Coen Brothers movies with you that I have that problem for me.
Yeah. I'm not trying to ruin it for everyone else, and I don't see how I could. Yeah, I'm more interested to hear how you felt about it.
I thought it was a lot of fun, and it hit its big emotional moments for me very well. I thought it was kind of combining a, you know, talking about the genre of the multiverse movie or the alternate universe movie. It kind of doing a multiverse take on It's a Wonderful Life with this woman who has infinite potential but is living the life where she's made all of the wrong turns and feels like a failure, and then has her heroic call, but with all of this wacky psychedelic humor that also does have definitely have some Lynchian nods in it. Like I felt like the decision to put a mother-daughter relationship at the cosmic center of this battle against evil rippling across the universes was inspired by Twin Peaks The Return, although obviously it's a very different tone. So I enjoyed it a lot, and the big juicy emotional beats worked on me. I had the tears going, but at the end of the day it was not entirely my thing, and I probably wouldn't sit through it again.
Okay.
That said, the central performances were fantastic, so sitting through it once was fine.
And Jamie Lee Curtis is pretty fun,
yeah,
in her
that's
role.
True. How could I forget Jamie Lee Curtis as well?
Did you just staple that to my head? It was probably the funniest line in the movie.
I hate to be such a downer, because this movie does have a reputation of being a probably a very rare, extreme feel-good movie made in this day and age, but this is a movie that's dealing with the question of what is the cosmos for? And the answer turns out to be love and kindness and wackiness make the bad parts worthwhile. And I'm like, fine, but you're asking about like the cosmos. Fine, but you know, what about genocide? You know what I mean? It's just not tackling enough. And maybe that's a different way of saying what you were saying, which is maybe it should just be about a family drama and not try to take on the cosmos and the meaning of existence.
I would have preferred it that way. Next up, Who's Afraid of Virginia Woolf?
This is a movie and a play that I know very, 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 very well. So I'm more interested to start with how you felt about it, because I don't think, you said you hadn't seen the movie since the 80s. I'm sure you've never read the play.
No, it's never been a favorite of mine. It's certainly an opportunity for great acting by our central pair and also by our secondary pair. I honestly don't know exactly what you're supposed to make of any of the things that are going on in the movie. It is, I guess, a fascinating exploration of the secret life of a relationship.
You know, I think that's it. That's really it.
In a way, you could almost see it as a strange precursor of, you know, the Phantom Thread, like the way a couple can somehow, you know, seem to hate each other or poison each other or throttle, or, I mean, all the other things that they do to each other. But they're the only two people that understand each other in any sort of a way that makes life tolerable, maybe, or almost tolerable. The difference with these two is that they seem to need an audience to really get going. And the Phantom Thread couple, I mean, it's more of a chamber drama. But these two, like, they're just a normal bickering couple when they're alone. But when other people show up...
Well, not that normal. I mean, they have invented, spoilers, a child.
Yeah, but the problems really begin...
As well as possibly many other strange, emotionally charged fantasies.
Yeah, but it's all about if other people are told about it or not. That's why he says, don't start going on about the little nipper or whatever he says.
Well, that seems like to be like he's somehow unconsciously provoking everything else that happens this night.
Maybe. It's a wild and crazy ride, for sure.
It was oddly, I wasn't expecting this to be a summer crowd pleaser, but they did put it in one of the big theaters, and the audience seemed to be, like, really into it.
It's a restoration. It looked beautiful. It actually opens, strangely, I was thinking of the beginning of The Letter, this town by moonlight. It looked like the very opening scenes of The Letter. Maybe it's because I subconsciously remembered that they started talking about a Betty Davis movie right away. Not The Letter, but Beyond the Forest. Great performance by Elizabeth Taylor, who's, what, she's like 35 or 36 in this movie, but she seems very convincingly middle-aged and over the hill, but still sexy.
Oh my god, her, not just that aspect that she's playing older, but this performance is just one of the greatest of all time. Brilliant.
Yeah.
It's brilliant. She's brilliant. Every single contradictory note of this character and the intelligence of the character and the emotion of the character is caught.
And Richard Burton, I mean, matches her.
Of course. Yeah. Burton's character in this movie is just the most repellent sadistic bully. He's just the worst. He's so much worse than she is, although that becomes a debate, who's worse than the other.
Yeah, I'm not sure about that. I think they're both behaving pretty badly.
But the way he just bullies and bullies and bullies Sandy Dennis because he doesn't think she's interesting enough to be treated like a human being. Like, that's the only possible reason that he just keeps taking everything out on her.
Yeah, well, if you take her as the litmus test for whether they're good people or not, then yeah, Elizabeth Taylor looks much better because she takes care of her and makes her coffee. And meanwhile, Richard Burton is trying to force her to kill herself.
This is exactly what I mean. And it's because, you know, he feels so henpecked and destroyed and emasculated by Elizabeth Taylor that he can only get that out of his system by treating somebody the way that he feels that he's treated by her. But, sorry, what were you going to say before I go on?
Well, I just wanted to see how you feel about this. It's meaningless, but I just couldn't help feeling that Richard Burton somehow, the great matinee idol Richard Burton, was looking a lot like 1980s Jerry Lewis in this movie.
Sure, sure. He's very convincingly a dowdy professor.
Yeah, he really inhabits the role.
They both do. When I was a teenager who wanted to be a playwright, this was one of the seminal plays of the 20th century English language theater, and
it did influence Live Through It.
No.
It didn't?
Sort of. I wrote the first drafts of the play before I'd read it.
Oh.
But it was one of the... Oh, the play is called Live With It.
Sorry.
You were confusing it with the whole album, which I find flattering.
Oh, sorry.
No, that seriously, I do. So I read the play many, many times. And looking back now, I would say, because it's been a long time since I've seen the movie, the play and the movie informed my conception of what adult life was. I mean, I guess some people just have versions of this, low-rent versions of this as their parents, and then they could be directly informed of what adult life is. But like you, you know, I just took that for granted when I was reading it and watching it when I was very young. But now that I'm almost 50, watching the movie again, like you, I was grappling with, what is this actually about? What is this play actually about? And what I came up with is very close to what you were saying, which is the greatness of the play, besides the fact that obviously the dialogue is brilliant and funny and very musical and perfectly poised between naturalism and stylization, abstraction, as are the characters. I haven't read much else by Elby after this goes more in the direction of abstraction, but the greatness of the play is in these characters and their relationship that spills off the page that you could write endless essays about and still not fully grasp it because they are so complex and enigmatic. And for all of that, it still captures certain things that are true about long-term relationships and long marriages, I would say. Obviously, very exaggeratedly, although apparently Albie did base this couple on a hard-drinking intellectual couple that he knew, in part. So that's all it's about, and I think that's all it has to be about, just writing two great characters in a fascinating relationship in a way that works dramatically.
Yeah, I'm sure we'll talk about it someday on the podcast. I don't think we currently have it scheduled, but no. We may do an Elizabeth Taylor spotlight or a Richard Burton.
Or a Burton Taylor spotlight.
Next up, Spellbound. This one is on the schedule, but not until 2035, so good decade away.
I hadn't seen this since my 20s. I didn't remember a single thing about it. I think I maybe saw it once. It doesn't have the reputation of some of the other Hitchcock films from the 40s and later. The Hollywood Hitchcocks. Not one of the most celebrated Hollywood Hitchcocks, I guess is what I'm trying to say.
Yeah, that's interesting, because for me it has always been one of the core Hitchcocks.
I absolutely loved it.
Yeah, it's a great movie. It's got a somewhat simplistic interpretation of dream interpretation. I don't know what else you could say against it. And even that, I mean, they've just turned it into something so fun and cinematic, that how can you hold that against it?
I remember just a few episodes ago, what was the movie we were talking about where you brought up Spellbound? What the movie is saying about Ingrid Bergman's professionalism or compromise as a female psychiatrist?
Yeah.
Which was the movie that we were...
I think it was the Audrey Totter performance, right? In High Wall.
Right, High Wall. So I was thinking about that while we were watching this, and a lot of the movie looks forward to Marnie, doesn't it?
Yeah, absolutely. I think this is a core Hitchcock film.
Yeah. And there was a lot of stuff in Marnie that I thought was just coming out of his pathological relationship toward, not with, but toward Tippi Hedren.
I mean, the Rhonda Fleming character is Marnie in embryo. I mean, she doesn't get to do a lot in the movie, but she certainly lingers in the mind. And
so is the early Ingrid Bergman in the movie. But also she's in the Mark Rutland role, you know, in a personal relationship with the person that she's trying to be a therapist to.
Yeah.
And I said when we were talking about High Wall that I didn't think that Hitchcock is interested in anybody's professionalism. It's just not a concern for him how well a person performs as a professional. This movie, co-written by Ben Hecht, does make a lot of comments about her gender and how it's affecting her as a professional, as a therapist. But ultimately, she's actually one of the most superheroic. Like, all of that gets hand-waved. Her career is not in any way affected. And she's presented as one of the most superheroic Hitchcock protagonists.
And one of the few Hitchcock films where a woman is the protagonist. And she is in charge for the most part throughout, even though she's feeling a little bit at sea because of this upswell of emotion that she's not accustomed to. She doesn't go to pieces. I mean, she keeps Gregory Peck
together. Everything she's doing is completely morally and professionally suspect, and she obviously should lose her psychoanalyst license.
No, but she doesn't because she's proven to be right.
Yeah.
Every step of the way. So the movie makes that decision that we're just going to have to go with her and trust that she understands what's happening here better than any of the rest of us, even better than Dr. Brueldorf.
And we are supposed to, of course, doubt her and both fear... And by doubting her, in part based on her gender, by doubting her, we are supposed to both fear her and fear for her. Fear what she's potentially doing to him and also what he could do to her.
Hitchcock, we've talked many times. I mean, part of his art is that he is something of a sadist. He's got a problem with women that comes out in some of his films. Gregory Peck gets to say some really nasty things to her.
Well, also this is Ben Hecht,
yeah,
who also has issues with that.
True. But like we just had the boys from Brazil last week and mentioned that Gregory Peck was pretty nasty at will in films. He's not always Atticus Finch, and he's not very likable in this movie.
Well, you know, it's doing a suspicion thing among all the other things it's doing where we are supposed to wonder if he is in fact a murderer. We should stop talking though, because we are going to do this for the podcast.
Yeah, 11 years from now.
Oh, 11 years from now, okay. The scariest moment in the whole movie is when you think he might murder this cute little Freudian psychoanalyst.
It's an amazing performance by Michael Chekhov.
Yeah.
Playing on that stereotype, yeah. But he's so much more...
Well, I mean, the character is playing on that stereotype.
That's what I mean, yeah. Ingrid Bergman, that's one thing that she's not exactly right about. She thinks he is just an absent-minded professor, but he's got a better sense of how things could go off the rails. Now, the movie splits the difference because it turns out that, yeah, Gregory Peck might sleepwalk around the house with a razor blade, but he's not actually going to kill anyone. But just to be safe, better knock him out with enough bromides to put an elephant to sleep. That way you get better dreams out of him, too. And that's where the Salvador Dali comes in.
True.
I guess we should leave it at that, and we'll revisit this film in much greater detail when we do our Ingrid Bergman spotlight in the mid-2030s. Next week on the podcast, it's the finale of our Lily Palmer actorist overview, The Whole Croft Covenant, and The Other Side of the Wind.
Oh, we're finally going to see The Other Side of the Wind.
Yeah, I mean, I've been holding off on watching it because I knew it was coming up at the end of the Lily Palmer. So it'll be our first viewing of that resurrected Orson Welles masterpiece, possibly.
Back when it was important to have an opinion, we didn't.